Meerkat pivots, $25 Apple Watches for fitness buffs, and the top five gaming stories of the week. All that and more on Tech News Today.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Tech News Today is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. Hi, everybody. It's time for our annual audience survey. We'd really like to hear from you. It helps us understand our audience better, know what you like and don't like, how you listen to the show. It also helps us tell advertisers what kind of people listen. But I promise you, your feedback is always kept personally anonymous. All you have to do is visit twit.tv/survey and let us know what you think. It'll just take a few minutes, and it'll help us make Twit even better. We really appreciate your support and any help you can give us. twit.tv/survey.
This is Tech News Today, episode 1463, recorded Friday, March 4th, 2016. This episode of Tech News Today is brought to you by NatureBox. NatureBox is dedicated to making smart, delicious snacking easy. They have over 100 ridiculously delicious snacks that get delivered directly to your doorstep. Visit naturebox.com/twit to get 50% off your first box now.
And by Score Big, pay less for quality seats to your favorite sporting and music events. Go to scorebig.com, click on the microphone, and enter promo code TNT to save $20 off your first ticket purchase.
And by PillPack, a full-service pharmacy that combines modern technology, convenient packaging, and personalized service to make your life easier. Visit pillpack.com/twit to save $20 on vitamins and OTCs when you transfer your prescriptions.
Hello, and welcome to Tech News Today. This is the show where we talk about all the tech news with people who really dig technology.
Get down with it. Oh, sorry.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. See?
Exactly.
He's
with
us. Can't help it. Yeah. Who are you?
I am Megan Maroney.
Who am I? I'm at Jason Howell on Twitter, or just Jason Howell. I don't know why you need to know my Twitter name right off the top. But joining us today, you heard his voice, the sultry tones of Ken Denmead from GeekDad.com. How's it going, Ken?
Oh, it's going great. Yeah, I think, you know, obviously in the future, we'll all just be known by our Twitter handles.
I know.
So hi, I'm at Ken Denmead.
There we go. Yes, it's our identity going forward, whether we like it or not.
Yeah.
It's great to get you back on the show. It's been a while since we've had you on TNT. Tell everybody who maybe isn't too familiar what GeekDad.com is all about.
Well, GeekDad is the parenting blog for the geek generation. You know, we all grew up, you know, going to cons when they weren't gigantic events. And we all grew up playing D&D, you know, after school and building our TRS-80s and so forth. And now we've all got kids, and we kind of want to raise our kids in our own geeky image. So I've got a wonderful group of geeky parents from all over the United States and actually all over the world. And we just write about what we love as geeks and as parents.
That's awesome. You guys write some really great stuff. We're actually going to be talking about some of the stuff from your site a little bit later in the show. But like I said, it's awesome getting you on the show today. We've got some interesting stuff to talk about here off the top, some of today's news. First up, 1 year ago at the South by Southwest Festival in Austin, Texas, a scrappy little upstart live video streaming service called Meerkat became the talk of the festival. Live video streaming, if you remember, was beginning its sudden ascension into the minds of tech users as the next big thing in social. And Meerkat was there at the right time. They were kind of riding some of the early waves, getting a lot of press in the process. But since then, major competing services from Twitter and Facebook have all but demolished mindshare of Meerkat. And so 1 year later, Meerkat apparently is going public with the news that it's pivoting away from live video streaming and into becoming a video social network. So a social network, you know, that kind of emphasizes video. I guess they realized last August that things needed to change because, I mean, it really was like, I mean, it was one of those scenarios where everybody was talking about Meerkat. Everyone was doing the Meerkat thing. And then suddenly, no more Meerkat. Like, it just was not even part of the conversation anymore. So they realized they needed to make a change, and they're doing that.
Yeah, I mean, Kurt Wagner broke this story on Recode, and he didn't have a lot of details about what the new Meerkat would be. But one, he said it was a social network where everybody is always live, which to me, totally terrifying.
Yeah.
That's a little bit scary. I think my only comment here is, I hope they call it Warthog.
It's possible. possible.
But aren't social networks already always live? I mean, okay, if it's video and always live, that's a little bit scary because usually we're sitting in our PJs on the sofa tweeting while we're watching a TV show. Otherwise, I don't think I want to, get pulled into that kind of conversation. Of course, they've probably got some kind of idea. Meerkat was really, really hot. And everybody wanted to have that app on their phone. I think we all just sort of realized after a little bit that it doesn't look that good to have live conversations with your phone. It bounces all around and you're going to lose signal after a while. So hopefully they can take it to another level, but I'm a little bit skeptical right now.
Yeah, I suppose we'll see. I think one interesting point that I gathered from the Recode article, as far as their reasoning for switching, is that they admitted that, you take like photo sharing, for example. Everybody knows what a good photo is. Everybody takes pictures all the time. They're very used to it since before the internet, even before the internet existed, people were very used to taking pictures and always trying to improve them and show the best ones to, their friends or their relatives, whatever. That's like ingrained in us. But when it comes to live video, this is a new concept for a lot of people. What constitutes good live video? Why am I, random person on the internet, choosing to share this random thing in live video form to a bunch of strangers? And is that compelling? Do people actually want it? And do I know how to make something that people want to see? Does it matter?
I think it can be compelling, but most of the time it's not. Mm-hmm. I mean, we have a lot of equipment here. We have a lot of people, a lot of lights, makeup, all the things. And, still it doesn't necessarily compare to what people are used to seeing on TV. So I don't know. I mean, I have certainly seen like people at conferences and stuff, writers, like tech writers that I really like. I've seen them and they've just been introduced to a product. They're super excited about it. It's their off the cuff, thoughts about it. And I really like that. But then a lot of times you'll just look at just random people and think, wow, like I am wasting my time.
What am I doing watching you right now?
I mean, isn't this a little bit what Vine tried to do? But then people started overproducing Vines.
Yeah.
To make them compelling. So right. I'm not sure where you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
So Ken, you said Meerkat was really hot. I think we've said that, but was it? I mean, that's the thing. Like, I'm not sure it was ever really hot. Like, I think that it was
buzzy.
Yeah,
it was buzzy because of us, because of people like us, like me. I won't blame anyone else, but people like me, narcissistic journalists that like these kinds of things and want people to see them talking about stuff. And we talked about the app and said how great it was, but it never caught on as much as we, made people believe that it had,
Everybody wants to be the one that calls the next big thing. And there for a while, it seemed like live streaming video from the palm of your hands was the next big thing. I'm not necessarily like at the point where I'm willing to say that it's not going to be a big deal at some point, because you do have Facebook pushing it hard. And if there's a company that could potentially turn this into a very successful thing, just kind of genre of content online, Facebook's certainly one of the companies is poised to do that. But I think the same challenges face Facebook, which is, still people aren't as aware of what makes really good, compelling live content. Facebook, reportedly is paying celebrities to get them to use the live streaming things. And Mark Zuckerberg is apparently obsessed with live videos. So they're all in on it. It just really remains to be seen if the users are going to be all in on it at some point.
Yeah, I mean, beyond the compelling uses of live video for covering breaking news events and so forth, it doesn't necessarily, this is a tough nut to crack. I'll just put it that way.
Yeah. I mean, even the citizen journalism, that was the other thing that we were saying. It's great if you're on the scene. I mean, there was a lot of riots and things like that. But even then, it doesn't tell the whole story. And often that can really, if it's not a journalist that's taking this video, you're not seeing the whole, you're seeing just a very small part of it. That can cause some problems too.
I think. It can be powerful, good and bad.
Yes.
It's no portrait mode.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, there's that. That's a whole other issue.
Unless you're on Snapchat. Well, let's move on. The Wall Street Journal reports that three companies are offering their employees an Apple Watch for the low, low price of $25, with no strings attached, oh, except for this one very big string. If the employee doesn't meet regular fitness goals after a two-year period, they will have to pay full price for the Apple Watch. Now, that could be anywhere from $350 to $17,000 if you opt for the gold Apple Watch, but I'm guessing this offer is probably just for the sport edition, since it's designed to encourage employees to be healthier, make healthier choices, be more active.
Kind of done on a monthly basis. So essentially, every month is worth $13.50. So if you miss a month, if you miss your goals in a month, you actually owe $13.50 for that month. So you'd have to be really bad to be, really just not care at all and be super cool with just paying full price if you agree to do this and then don't meet your goals and pay on a monthly basis. But it's interesting, and it's not the first time that this has happened. Target's doing this with their employees with Fitbits. United Health Group is doing this with a custom fitness tracker, but also offering a cash incentive. My question is, how effective is it? Does it actually work in the long run? What do you think, Ken? Is this a good incentive for people to kind of get up and move?
Well, I think obviously we need a sample size, and there's a lot of fun in the idea that, the bottom line is companies are looking for ways to make sure their employees are fit, which then will lower the amount of money they have to pay into health, covering health insurance. So obviously there is a balance sheet issue here from the company's point of view. There might be some altruism involved too. And jumping on, gadget bandwagons like Apple Watches and Fitbits and so forth. Yeah. I love my Apple Watch for tracking fitness, but you know what? I had a Pebble before that and it worked well for that too and is a little bit cheaper. But, it's changing the culture. So if you're going to offer something like this, let's make sure that your commissary is also offering a lot of healthy options and that you don't have junk food in the vending machines and so forth. It needs to kind of be a holistic approach. It's fun. And hopefully people will use it in the manner in which it's expected I hope it helps people.
Sure. Ken, I have a blog idea for you. I don't know if you have ever done this, but here's a hack for trying to keep up to your fitness goals. Put your watch on your child's and just have them run around with it for a while. And then, it only takes probably, I don't know. I have 2 fifth graders and, sometimes they put on my watch and all my calories that I need to burn for a day happen in 15 minutes, pretty much, just with the running and the spinning. So.
My kids.
It's a great idea, but both my boys and their teenagers have their own fitness trackers. So they're already loaded up.
See, I know what you're talking about, but I can only put it in the context of YouTube recommendations. Because my kids go crazy on my YouTube account. And then I see lots of princess videos. Aren't I lucky? I think this is interesting. I think, yes, part of it is the whole healthcare aspect. I think another part of it, too, is just kind of employee morale, right? Like having the opportunity. I mean, yes, you do have a bargain to hold up your end of, but really it's kind of doing something that's good for you. And in the end, you get this nice Apple Watch as a gift.
Right. But I mean,
that makes you feel good as an employee, I suppose.
Yes. But let's remember, it's not just a fitness tracker. I mean, it is a way that employers can track you in other ways.
A fitness tracker.
I sent you a text. Why didn't you answer it? You can't say you weren't near your phone anymore because it's always on you. Like, I mean,
it's a tracker.
It is. It's like, I remember back. I'm old enough to remember the days of pagers, and I had a job where I had to carry a pager around, and that was like the beginning of the end in terms of like having your own free time and also having a job where people wanted to know where you are and get your attention at any time.
So. At all times.
Yeah, I've worked for enough very large companies that the efficiency with which they keep track of this kind of thing is never as good as you might be afraid of.
Right. Big Brother is not very good at being Big Brother most of the time.
Yeah exactly.
So back in 2014, the EU court ruled that Google must remove search results when called upon by European users to do so, something now widely known as the right to be forgotten. Up until today, Google was delisting results for only its European sites and by extension, not delisting them on sites like Google.com. So, .com or .co.uk would get delisted, but not Google.com. Well, starting next week, Google will be delisting from all of its sites. As long as the user is seen as connecting from the area, from the EU. IP addresses are going to be analyzed and in other ways of geolocating users to, you know, make sure that they are from there. And if so, hiding search results. How do you feel about this, Megan?
Oh, I have so many feelings about the right to be forgotten. I mean, first of all, every time we talk about this, I just said, like, the name, the right to be forgotten is not, I mean, it's censorship. That's my belief. That's what it is. It's super complicated. I mean, we were talking about it before. I mean, Google is doing this because they have to. They're kind of following the letter of the law. But, you know, anyone using a VPN can get around this. It's, I mean, I don't know. I mean, the way that the right to be forgotten has worked so far is Google's made it so difficult for people that it's only mostly big corporations that can get their things cleaned up and not the people that really need it, not the people like, you know, victims of revenge porn or, you know, anyone who's being stalked. Those are not the people that are taking advantage, by and large, of the right to be forgotten. So, yeah, I mean, they're doing it because they have to.
Yeah, and I don't think it's going to be that successful. Although I immediately predict you, Megan, you mentioned people with VPNs. How many services are going to pop up with, you know, little companies that say they've got VPNs tunneling into, you know, Northern Ireland so that you can apply, you know, pay them $100 and they'll apply to Google to get you forgotten in the world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it'll never work.
Yeah. Or VPNs selling themselves as access to all the things you aren't seeing right now. All it costs is $59 a month.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, I'm sure we will, this is not the last time we'll get to talk about the right to be forgotten.
Yeah, it keeps evolving.
The website Hackaday says that Google is building a ginormous radio transmitter in the New Mexico desert, and nobody knows what it's for. One intrepid reporter dug up some government documents showing that Google asked the FCC to treat some information relating to radio experiments with millimeter wave technology as confidential. The document is mostly redacted and doesn't reveal much, but I mean, what could possibly, you know, go wrong with testing something in the New Mexico desert?
So what do we think? E.T.?
Yeah,
Google's phoning home?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's the obvious thing that's happening here. I don't know. Do you have any theories on this, Ken?
They found Thor's hammer, and they're trying to open the Rainbow Bridge. That's about it.
Well, I think they suspect it's Project Skybender, which is Google's 5G internet drones.
Okay. All right.
Skynet? Did you say Skynet?
Close.
I might have.
Google may be working on Skynet in many other ways, but this is just 5G that we're talking about.
Yeah.
So not quite Skynet entirely. All right. Well, we don't have a whole lot more on that because we know nothing. But
no.
It's fun to theorize, isn't it? And I choose to go with aliens.
Mm-hmm.
TechCrunch sources say Microsoft once considered an $8 billion acquisition of enterprise messaging business Slack. Ultimately, though, Microsoft CEO Satya Nadella and co-founder Bill Gates passed, opting for improving the features of its Skype product to make it more competitive with Slack. In the long run, the acquisition may have run around $8 billion, according to sources, while its current valuation is more around $3.5 to $5 billion. So Microsoft, yeah, may have paid a pretty penny for this had they chosen to do so. And I don't know. I mean, we use Slack right now for TNT. It's made certain aspects of production of this show pretty darn easy. So it's easy to see why it would be a target. I guess last year, the CEO, Stuart Butterfield, had mentioned they'd had around 8 to 10 acquisition offers by May. I kind of wonder if Microsoft was one of those at that time. But yeah, could you see a world, Ken, in which Slack was consumed by the Microsoft spaceship and integrated?
Oh, please no. And I think we dodged a bullet here. GeekDad is entirely on Slack. That's how, in an active sense, we coordinate everything for the blog because, as I said, we've got contributors all around the world. So I don't want to see Slack get gobbled up, repurposed, you know, turned into something else, or just, you know, put out the pasture and killed. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping that either they will continue as their own solo endeavor, or if someone does pick them up, someone is going to nurture them and keep them going. Because, you know, there have been many different services that have been like this in certain ways, but it's weird. Slack just seems to have hit the nail on the head. And, you know, it's like butter. It's wonderful to use. It's totally effective. And I would be in deep pain if we had to give it up and try and figure something else out.
So when you say entirely on Slack, does that mean you don't use email at all to communicate with the people on Geek Dad?
That's really the second sort of second level, broader, you know, slow-mo communication stuff. But mm-hmm. we even have a kludge set up where things that go out over to certain formats of email, you know, when people are like saying, hey, I'm going to review this, it gets dumped into a Slack room so that people can check and search there.
Oh, interesting.
We should do that. Yeah, because I really like Slack, but it does seem like it hasn't replaced email. But that's not Slack's fault. I mean, it's kind of like this morning.
That's
like,
just the deeply ingrained like habit and you know, structure of email. And,
right.
You know,
email is sending memos around and making sure you've got something to tack up on your wall. Slack is everybody chatting with each other live. I mean, it's sort of like internal Twitter or something like mm-hmm. that. It's, you know, it's chat rooms.
Yeah.
It's good old fashioned AOL chat rooms for business. But it's working.
Okay, yeah. So the other question here is, okay, so we can't see, or maybe we collectively hope that Microsoft doesn't end up with Slack because we like Slack the way it is. Can you see a world in which Skype is a Slack competitor? I'm not sure that I see that.
Well, you can call with Slack now, right? Just starting.
Right, they
had
the video, the audio and video calling that they've just announced, but I don't know. Skype seems like a piece.
I don't think they've got the mindshare for it at this point.
Have you started using Slack to make
I've not tried it yet. Yeah. We've enabled it in our system and a couple of people have played with it. But again, you know, most of us are doing other things while we're sitting, you know, the chat rooms are sitting on a corner of your desktop. You're doing other productive stuff. Somebody catches your eye, you respond to them, something happens there and you go back to it. It's not mm-hmm. always constant one-on-one or one-to-many, many-to-one communication. It's another tool.
Yeah.
So,
all right. Well, some breaking news. SpaceX launched the Falcon 9 about a half an hour. I don't know if they've landed it yet, and I don't know if they were supposed to. I know I watched the takeoff. I mean, anytime anybody says like T-minus anything, it's just exciting. And so the first four launches of this were scrubbed. This is the second launch for SpaceX, ninth launch of any communication satellite. They passed supersonic. They headed into the vacuum of space. The main engine was cut off. All these things happened. Other missions were easier because they were in lower Earth orbit, but this one was traveling faster. I see in the chat room that the Falcon 9 booster did not survive landing. That's confirmed by SpaceX. Thank you, SpaceX. I know, it's sad, but yeah, it got up.
Excellent. You keep getting opportunities to see this kind of stuff.
I think,
it's nice to see it finally actually happen because we were trying to talk about it a couple of days ago. Nope.
I know.
It's kind of sad that their beta testing is so public.
Yeah.
But also kind of exciting for anyone who enjoys sitting on the sidelines and watching it
Fiery
all happen.
And exciting,
you know?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, it must be like a big Geek Dad, you know, conversation too, because that's something that
we track a lot of this stuff over the years. We've had various members who are actually worked for NASA, and so there's always been this corner of Geek Dad that's all the space nerds, and we love it.
I definitely have two little space nerds at home who are excited about this, and they didn't expect it to really land. If you think about what they're trying to do, it's mm-hmm. amazing. Mm-hmm. So fifth time's a charm.
All right, we've got a bunch of gaming stuff coming up here. Normally, you know, on Fridays, we always invite Sam Moscovich from Ars Technica on to talk about gaming. But we also have Ken, and he's got a lot of stuff on gaming. So we're going to have two back-to-back segments all about gaming. But first, let's take a minute to thank the sponsor of this episode before we go any further, and that's NatureBox. If you're tired of eating the same bland food while trying to stay healthy, well, then you need mini Belgian waffles or any other of the 100 snacks that NatureBox offers. Making smarter choices doesn't mean that you have to eat boring food. NatureBox makes snacks that are full of flavor and none of the junk, so you can find the snacks that you want without wasting time, you know, questioning the ingredients. What are they? What's made? What is that made of? What, you know, what kind of food coloring? All that kind of stuff. They have NatureBox has just a wide assortment of options for you. Vegan, no sugar added, non-GMO options. You can choose between savory, sweet, salty, and tart flavors. Some of my favorites that I keep coming back to, Asiago and cheddar cheese crisps. Guacamole bites are awesome. Super easy to fill out your own snack profile, and you'll get personalized recommendations based on your preferences. So you just kind of go on the site, plug in a few things that you like, They'll tell you what else you might like. And, you know, they're always adding new and interesting snacks for you to discover. So you don't always know what's offered because there's new stuff being offered all the time. NatureBox believes that you shouldn't eat something you don't like. So if you try a snack, you don't actually like it, they'll replace it in your next box for free. Can't do that with your other snacks. Go to naturebox.com/TWIT right now. You'll get 50% off your first box of delicious and unique snacks without any of the junk. That's naturebox.com/twit for 50% off your first box of the best tasting snacks in the world. And we thank NatureBox for their support of Tech News Today.
Now is the time where we get to check in with Sam Moscovich, culture reporter from Ars Technica. We talk about the craziest, most exciting, drool-worthy gaming news. Sam, are you there?
I am here. Hey, everybody.
Oh, hey, we're doing a show. I don't know if you knew that. It looks like you're wearing a Vive right now.
Well, I'm technically in a way cooler place than you guys could possibly imagine. I'm currently hanging out with whales and manta rays. I'm doing pretty good. So I thought I'd show off my sweet new toy, which just came in a giant box the other day. I don't know that we're going to necessarily talk about virtual reality, but I'm happy to add a virtual reality tinge take on this week's news.
It would be awesome if we could have like the, oh, cool.
Oh, there we go. Yeah. Wow, it's dueling VR right now.
That is great.
Which one do you have, Ken?
Oh, this is a very, very inexpensive knockoff kind of drop your phone into VR headset that
it's been really removed at this point.
See, you missed it. You missed it, Sam. Those are the kinds of things you miss when you're behind that headset.
It's true.
I don't want to make you guys jealous, so I'll just say, sure, you're right. Yeah, whatever. This is my new sweet hat. I'm going to wear this all around the streets of Seattle. I hope it looks real cool.
Yeah, it does.
All right,
watch out for low door jams.
Yeah.
Good point. Tell us about No Man's Sky from Hello Games. You got to take a sneak peek at that this week.
I did. No Man's Sky has been talked about a lot for about 2 years since it was unveiled at the E3 conference in 2014 as a giant, seemingly endless space exploration game with an estimate of 17 quintillion planets in this galaxy is what they've estimated, the folks at Hello Games. Hello Games was known to gamers before this as the makers of a little game called Joe Danger, which was a very simple, very fun touchscreen and Xbox game. And now they've come up with a game that's all about, as the creator says, maths. Sean Murray, the founder and head programmer of Hello Games, essentially came up with a series of formulas that all emanate from sort of a Big Bang. It's a math Big Bang where all these formulas work to create all of the content in the game. Just the idea of just like hundreds of thousands of math equations, all sine and cosine kind of functions, all colliding together to create rivers and valleys and mountains and caverns and all this sort of content. And what happens is you're thrown in this game and you just fly from planet to planet. And the question is, how is this actually a game as opposed to just a giant math experiment? And that's sort of what we got to find out. We were flown to Los Angeles on Tuesday to check out a private demonstration of the gameplay parts in which you are essentially surviving. There are a lot of these open world games now where you're expected to survive. You're expected to find resources, keep yourself healthy, get loot, get guns, get items. And that's sort of what's been attached to the game here, where you have to essentially find your way to the center of the universe by finding stuff on planet to planet, actually learning about the stuff on each individual planet in order to learn its language. It's all gibberish on each each planet has a totally different language. And you have to imagine a planet about half the size of the Earth that you have to scale in real time, either on foot or in a spaceship. And you have to like cover these planets all the way around in order to find everything that you need to get to the next planet to get you to the next planet. It's essentially a total obsessive compulsive nightmare / dream in terms of having to find all this stuff in a realistically sized universe. I assume that's what it's like to fly from planet to planet. I haven't really souped up my budget on space travel just yet. But they announced a release date coming late this June for PlayStation 4 and PCs. It'll be $60. This is not a digital download game. They're pushing this, I believe, as Sony's biggest game of the summer. And they're releasing it simultaneously on computer, which is not a usual move for Sony. So pretty cool all around. Not totally sure if it's going to be a great game, but it's incredibly fascinating just to look at and talk about. It looks beautiful, as you saw.
So No Man's Sky has gotten a lot of hype. Do you think it's lived it for you? Is it living up to the hype?
So I enjoyed what I played, but I had to really set my expectations for a game in which the aimlessness is built in. That this is not a game with end bosses. It's not a game with structured quests. It's more about what's over there. And they make it beautiful, and they make it easy to get around. It's easy to find a spaceship and fly around. It's easy to meet these weird creatures who all look really cool. They're also all procedurally generated using a mix of math and prearranged, pre-filtered bits and eyeballs and horns and wings and all this stuff. So getting lost in it is fascinating, interesting, and beautiful. Fun is not necessarily the word I'd use. And I think there are just enough people out there who will like this exact kind of dive through an endless galaxy. But the one thing that was interesting I found was the creator said 99.9% of the content that exists in this game's universe will never be found. That's how big this universe is. Even if millions of people play this game, there's a good chance that only 0.01% of the stuff that's automatically generated will actually be traversed by other people. So that's fascinating, but fun to play. That the jury's still out. We'll find out in June.
I guess that means replay value will be very high, if that's the case. About as high as it could possibly be.
You're never going to see your friend who's an obsessive compulsive completist ever again.
Yeah.
I just have to find one more planet. I just need to find one more planet.
Just one more. Interesting. So a game based around curiosity, basically. That's what it sounds like. Very cool stuff.
And the creator joked that Peter Molyneux was hidden at the center of the galaxy to tell everybody what was inside the Curiosity Cube. So if anyone is familiar with that whole Peter Molyneux mess of overpromising and underdelivering, they're dancing around that as well. So that was
I have no idea what you're talking about, but there's a lot of people giggling around me that do know. So.
Now you took your VR HTC Vive off.
I got VR hair now. Yeah, it's like hat hair, but way more expensive.
Took it off at exactly the wrong time. Oculus VR founder Palmer Luckey is dropping dynamite on Apple hardware. What exactly did he have to say about VR and the Mac?
Well, Palmer Luckey, the head and founder of Oculus, has been very brusque about the kind of things you need to run virtual reality. They're very, very demanding headsets. They need a lot of computing power, in particular, a good GPU, a good video card. They're recommending a minimum video card that's about $300, $320 just to get started, let alone all the other parts you need for a working computer. And Palmer, in an interview, talked about support for other platforms, just came out and said, Apple hardware's terrible. That it's specifically Apple computers have failed again and again to put enough juice into their GPU parts. So he said, you know, if Apple ever releases a good computer, is what he said, we will do it. As in, we will put, you know, Oculus Rift support on OS X. So I don't hold my breath about that, because as he said, and as we at Ars Technica wrote about, Apple has just under-delivered on that part of their computers for a long time, which has really hurt in terms of these Retina displays that tend to be standard. You get a MacBook now, which has zillions of pixels, all nice and dense, and it takes a really good video card to render on those, and you can't really do incredible-looking gaming like on the PC like you can on a Mac. So I don't see that changing for a while. I don't see Oculus coming to Mac anytime soon. I think Palmer's totally on the money. That was such an easy slam dunk of a diss.
Mm-hmm. Now, by the way, you were showing off your Vive. You've been living with this for a couple of days now. I tried the Vive for the first time yesterday, and I was pretty blown away. Tell us about your thoughts after kind of having this for a few days now. Well, yeah, there I am. Here's my VR face.
Right, you were canoeing, I believe. That doesn't look like canoeing. It looks like you were doing something way different.
So I was canoeing. It's a company called Immersive Entertainment. They had a Grand Canyon. And it's really hard to see here because by this point in the demo, the sun had gone down, so it was very dark. That guy had basically handed me a flashlight. And I'll tell you, like, the only way I can really put it is, like, it was incredibly trippy to be, like, out in a canoe, and then suddenly I see this flashlight appear in front of me. And when I reach my hands out in physical space, I grab the controller, and what I see is the flashlight come into my hands, and I'm suddenly shining light on everything. It was the craziest mixture of, like, virtual and real life. And totally unexpected. But what have your thoughts been on the Vive?
How many hours do you have to spare?
I feel like
I force conversations about this device into every segment whenever possible, because I am so impressed by it. I will say this is the first time I've actually had the chance to put it in my living room, just over there in my house. I'm calling you guys from my home. And I have these two tracking stations drilled into the ceiling, because the idea is there's two little boxes looking at you as you play, so that they can at all times recognize the headset and two of those controllers that you showed off. It's if you miss, if it can't see any of those at any time, you get jitter, you get shakiness, you end up feeling sick. It's a very important part of things. However, what I found is after getting those little guys up on my ceiling, that works incredibly. I've yet to have really any moment in which my tracking was lost, except for when I actually, and I am not kidding, got on my knees because I saw a tiny creature in one game and wanted to get a good look at it. And by doing that, that sort of messed with the tracker, and I had a little bit of a judder, and I said, nope, I'm getting back up. But that's how inviting the world is, that you see these little details and you want to get as close as possible and interact with them, because you're actually moving around. You don't get sick the way you do if you're sitting down and using an abstraction like an Xbox controller to move. Forget that. I can actually walk around a full living room space in order to interact with guns, with paintbrushes, with an office cubicle. There's so many weird demos right now because it's all cutting-edge stuff being essentially made by very small teams, 2 to 5 people. These nimble, weird indie groups are the ones that are currently taking the first big steps at virtual reality. So what I'm finding is it's a lot more reliable in my house than I expected. And I'm not getting bored with it or tired of it after having it for more than 15 minutes at a time, like at a demo. I'm going to have a lot to say about it. I'm going to have a video piece about installing it in my house. It's going to go up at Ars Technica next week, some stuff on the painting app. Basically, this is all I'm going to be talking about for the next couple of weeks, and all of my friends are already tired of it.
So the average person has to pay a lot of money and also kind of look a little bit silly and drill holes in their ceiling?
You can actually put these up in easier ways, okay. But you essentially need to get them above your head because they are looking down to track all the locations of this headset and the two little handheld controllers. So you might need a little camera tripod, you might need a nicely placed bookshelf, but the bigger deal is that you need to clear your living room floor.
Yeah, right.
Just right behind me is a coffee table that I've shoved out of my living room just so I can walk around. It's worked out pretty okay. But I have a housemate who doesn't appreciate having one of our thoroughfares essentially breaking fire code.
Just give them the headset. They'll get it.
There are definitely enough roadblocks for just average Joe.
Yeah.
And that's why they're not selling this at stores yet. This is the early going. They're going to sell the limited number for a high price. And people like myself are going to spend the next 8 months flipping out. And as the prices come down, as they figure out easier ways to track movement around a space, or make it easier to just use it at a desk, which you can do. You can actually use this sitting at a desk and just setting up the trackers there. You don't have to be standing. But the ability to stand, to move around, to move your hands really changes it compared to Google Cardboard or Samsung Gear VR. There's just something about being able to move that's transformative. I love it.
All right, moving on. Tim Sweeney from Epic Games had some strong words for Microsoft today, calling their gaming system a walled garden. Can you talk a little bit about this?
Yeah, sure. So Tim Sweeney over at Epic Games wrote a very long op-ed calling out Microsoft for what it felt like was an even bigger antitrust kind of violation than with Internet Explorer back in the 90s. His concern is that Microsoft's push for the Universal Windows Platform, UWP, on which Universal Windows Applications, UWA, sit. By the way, I hate these acronyms. but the idea is that having those built that way will make it easier to take games and apps and run them on different Windows devices, on Windows phones, on other kinds of phones, and on the Xbox. In fact, Phil Spencer made a big speech about this being a brand new era in which you may not, the Xbox will be kind of like a smartphone, and that you can get, a newer one every 2 years and you don't have to throw out your old games and all this. So that all sounded well and good, but Sweeney's concern is that you are locking out people from making content and distributing it themselves. That these apps, you can't just go on a website and download an .exe file the way you can with pretty much everything on Windows right now. And so many video game stores, including Steam, Good Old Games, and the terrible one that EA makes, whose name I forget, Origin, there it is, those would not operate and they wouldn't work. I do think that Sweeney is kind of on the hot air side of things when he goes on about this, because there's currently nothing stopping anybody from those marketplaces to make stuff on Windows. Furthermore, the Windows Store is not good. It's a mess. They did a launch of a new Tomb Raider game, which was just so many problems in terms of getting the game, installing it, being able to modify and change things. And so long as their service sucks, the market is going to respond accordingly. That's how it's been. That's why games for Windows Live didn't take off. That's why a lot of different Microsoft initiatives didn't take off. So I think all the other stores that are currently entrenched have nothing to fear until Microsoft makes a good product. And if they do, it's still not going to stop their products from being available and easily grabbable. It's not hard to go on a web browser and get Steam or get some of these other things. This isn't, you know, an archaic era where an average Windows user doesn't know how to navigate to a website and get a different, for example, Chrome. It's not hard to get Chrome. It's not pre-installed in Windows. People are getting that. And I think that's going to be the same case with video game stores as more people download digital copies of games. So I hear what Sweeney's saying, but I think that he's missing the point of Windows being able to try an option and the market being able to reject it very easily.
And finally, tell me when we can all begin to watch at home on repeat that Force Awakens scene where BB-8 flips off the camera. I mean, gives Finn a thumbs up, depending on how you interpret it. When can we start pre-ordering that and watching that?
You could start pre-ordering that yesterday, nice. And you can start watching it on April 1st, is when the digital download copy, not an April Fool's joke, is going to launch on the likes of iTunes, Amazon Video, and all the other usual suspects. In fact, the digital and Blu-ray versions both cost $20 right now if you want to go throw that money at it. The Blu-ray edition is going to come with a lot of featurettes and extended sequence stuff, deleted scenes. They are going to have footage of the very first table read for the movie, and that I really hope will have Carrie Fisher and Harrison Ford being curmudgeons. I really hope that's just unedited, raw kind of stuff, because I could imagine them really busting a few balls. The digital HD versions that you could get from iTunes and the like, there was a little asterisk on the listing saying that some of those storefronts won't have the same stuff as the Blu-ray. So if you want to see the behind-the-scenes stuff on BB-8, I really hope they get the guys who did the voices, I can't remember what it was called, but they had a couple of comedians, including Jean Ralphio from Parks and Rec, worked on all the beeps and bloops for BB-8. And I would really like to see a sequence with the humans putting together the BB-8 voices. And I know there's a BB-8 vignette in there somewhere. But yeah,
there has to be.
April 5th of this year for the Blu-ray and DVD. April 1st, if you can't wait 4 days.
Well, I just recently shelled out $98 for all 6 previous Star Wars movies, only 3 of which I will probably ever watch again. So I kind of wish they'd thrown this one in, but $20 isn't that much to spend.
You'll get it anyways.
Mm-hmm. I know. I will.
They know you
they
will.
Know that. What about you, Ken? Are you excited about, will you get the Blu-ray? Will you download
it? We'll get the Blu-ray. We'll watch it all. Absolutely. It was a breath of fresh air after many, many years in the desert.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No pun intended. Exactly. All right. Well, yesterday we talked about an app called Rando that would tweet out a text a random photo from your photo roll to a friend or just out to your Twitter account if that's what you wanted to do with your life, to just, play Russian roulette with your relationships. Alexander, whose username is Random Korean Guy, writes, "I felt uniquely qualified to comment on this topic in particular. I have to agree with Natalie. It's cheating a bit to use this app. If music apps are any indication, though, most people don't like true randomness anyway. Tweaking the random setting on music players is something they've been doing since the feature was invented. We need a little bit of a human touch in our randomness to give it a little bit of meaning and context. Otherwise, it's just chaos and anarchy. Just my 2 cents." He also sent us this obligatory random photo.
Animated photo.
Yes.
Okay, well, it could be much worse.
It could.
In fact, I think, there was another app called Rando. In the Google Play Store a couple of years ago. I actually reviewed it on All About Android, and it looks like they're not related. So same name, but different, but it was kind of the same idea where basically you would log in and you would take a picture and it would share a random picture with a random other user of Rando.
Oh, God.
And I think if memory serves, I risked doing that live on All About Android, and I think it bit me when I did that. So you always got to be careful when you're asking for a random picture from somebody. You never know what you're going to get.
Yeah. Natalie had pointed out that randomness was good, but when you fake it, like, you can't fake it. Like, you have to really be random. Mm-hmm. And so, good point. Thank you for that email. After the break, if you've got some change burning a hole in your pocket, Ken will pick some new games on Kickstarter that might be worth backing. But first, let's take a minute to thank Score Big, the sponsor of this episode. New York Philharmonic, AC/DC, Monster Jam, Janet Jackson, the LA Lakers, Wicked, Yanni, Iron Maiden, Justin Bieber, Detroit Tigers, Beyonce, Marvel Universe Live.
Did you say Yanni?
I said Yanni. Okay. That's what you picked out of that list? Yanni?
You know, I'm a fan. I celebrate his entire catalog.
I do not judge. This is just a very short list of some of the live events that you can get cheaper tickets to go see from ScoreBig. Whatever it is, you can bet that there is a way to pay less for better seats. How? Just go to scorebig.com. 40% of all live event tickets go unsold. ScoreBig is making it easy to attend live events by working directly with your favorite teams and artists to get their unsold seats at unpublished prices. At scorebig.com, you are always guaranteed huge savings by paying much less than what the box office charges for tickets. They have incredible deals on tickets to concerts, sports, Broadway, and family-friendly events. To take advantage of these amazing deals, visit scorebig.com and find the event and seats that you want. Then make an offer with ScoreBig's Name a Ticket Price feature. You will receive an answer from ScoreBig instantly, and you can save up to 60% on your tickets. You also have an option to pay a fixed price, which is much less expensive than major online ticket resellers. With ScoreBig, there are no surprise fees, and you get free shipping. You can even favorite shows and events to be notified on upcoming dates to attend, which is very convenient. So quit overpaying for tickets. Get the tickets that you want at prices you can afford with ScoreBig. The next time you're planning to attend a game or a show, visit ScoreBig first and see how much you can save. Go to scorebig.com, click on the microphone, and enter promo code TNT to save an extra $20 off your first ticket purchase. That's scorebig.com, promo code TNT.
All right, so back to a little bit more gaming stuff. So, Ken, you write a lot about gaming at GeekDad.com, well, you and all the other folks that you have writing for you. So let's talk about a few of those things that you have posted there. First, I'm a big fan of Fallout Shelter. It took me a little bit to get into it, but then I got totally addicted. It's a mobile game. You can get it on Android, iOS, and a bunch of other places. It looks like some new updates are being pushed to gamers. What can we look forward to?
Absolutely. So, this just came out. I've been playing Fallout Shelter for a while. In fact, amusingly, I played Fallout Shelter before I ever played a Fallout game. And so I dug the idiom, the look and feel. And once you get into it, you got to get used to the game. You got to find the balance of building the different types of rooms and keeping all of your inhabitants and your Fallout Shelter happy. Well, there's a big update coming out that actually brings this mobile game even closer to what it's like playing the video game on your console. And they're adding things like being able to craft. You know, one of the big deals in Fallout is you can run around everywhere, you can collect hundreds of different materials that it takes to then go and, you know, upgrade your weapons, do things to your armor, there's a whole food-based crafting that goes on in Fallout 4 that lets you, improve what the food could do for you in terms of your health and your abilities and so forth. And some of that is coming to this little mobile game that really is its own wonderful little world. It's like you're living in part of the Fallout universe, and you get to be the person in charge of this Fallout shelter for, 100 years, while a portion of humanity is kind of trying to hide away from the nuclear apocalypse on the surface. And, it's all about resource management and keeping your people happy. And now they've added crafting features and more. It's an incredibly deep game for a mobile game.
Yeah, it is. I would completely agree with that.
Mm-hmm. No, Sam, I know you're a big Fallout fan. Have you played Fallout Shelter? You're not a fan of Fallout? I thought you were.
I did not like Fallout 4, and I don't touch anything. Fallout Shelter to me is just, it's too difficult for me to enjoy mobile games that are that sort of way. because they sort of tap into my, what do I call it, slot machine sense, where I just want to poke away and get it. Anything with microtransactions is really dangerous for me.
Okay, so it's a personal problem.
Well, you got it. You know, the real problem. Challenge mode is to do it without microtransactions.
Right.
A lot slower that way. But yeah, but you know, in our family right now, me and my two sons, whoever gets home first and doesn't have to do homework, they're on Fallout 4 first. So we're all plowing our way through that game right now.
Right. And, you know, in the apocalypse, we know who's going to survive. Not Sam, probably.
Oh, yeah.
You're going to need some practice.
That's why he'll have his virtual reality.
It's not going to matter to Sam. He's going to have his own reality.
Exactly.
Yeah, I'm just going to be over here where people are nicer.
Okay. I have one more question. Can you play on the phone, or is it mainly for the tablet? Like, is it...
I've always played it on the phone.
Really?
I mean, you know, you'll do a little pinching and zooming, but yeah. I've been happy with it.
Excellent. All right, well, tell us about your Kickstarter picks, your gaming picks on Kickstarter, Ken.
Well, we do a lot. I mean, not just me, a bunch of our writers. We are huge fans of what Kickstarter has allowed, especially tabletop gaming enthusiasts to do. We are passionate about tabletop games, especially, you know, being able to share really cool tabletop games with our families, with our kids, and friends. Family game night is a really important thing to bring people together. And Kickstarter has allowed, you know, everybody talks about we're in a golden age of television, other things. We are in a golden age of tabletop gaming. And a big chunk of that, of the credit for that, goes to Kickstarter, because we're in this place now where anybody who has a very interesting idea for a tabletop game, who takes the time to, you know, make sure all the rules work really well and find an artist to do really cool cards or boards or layouts or whatever, you know, they can go to Kickstarter. They can raise $5,000 or $10,000 and go out. And there are numerous companies that are printing board games for, you know, sort of like you go to Cafe Press. And it's really fantastic. We almost on a daily basis, we'll have some sort of Kickstarter alert about a new tabletop game that's coming out. I tend to do a little summary once a week that has, you know, five new Kickstarter tabletop game projects and five new Kickstarter video game projects that come around. And everything runs the gamut. There's kid-friendly stuff. There's horror. There's, you know, some very adult games coming out too. You can find pretty much whatever you want. So I would, you know, hopefully urge everybody to take a stop by Geek Dad and just do a search on Kickstarter, and your minds will be blown by what the world of gaming is becoming. You know, it's not just Risk and Monopoly. In fact, our people will lynch you if you talk about Monopoly on our board. It's a whole new world of gaming, and hopefully, you know, people will start discovering it.
Excellent. I know I've seen a lot of lot of movement in that regard. I just wish that my kids were older because they could play some of these games. Right now, we are stuck in the world of Monopoly and Sorry and all that kind of stuff. And
you'll get there.
I don't know. We'll get there. One of these days.
Try Tsuro, T-S-U-R-O. It was a successful Kickstarter campaign, and it is the simplest concept, but it is so much fun. Kids can get it really easily, but there's endless replay value.
Nice.
Or Cards Against Humanity. They might have that.
We have that one. Six. We haven't busted that out on game night, though. Not yet.
Yeah, for kids who use Cards for Humanity.
Right. Let's see here. Okay, so this is a quick one. Let's take a look at this link. And by link, I actually mean Link from The Legend of Zelda. What has Google done, Ken?
This was a funny thing that just popped up. Probably, I think we just had some sort of Nintendo anniversary, I think. So this is probably in praise for that. But instead of the funny little yellow meeple person that you would normally see on your Google Maps and directions and so forth, all of a sudden, I guess this morning, today, Link from Legend of Zelda popped up as the figure that you would find on your Google Maps today. So another amusing and really geeky little Google in joke. And so I'm just wondering, you know, after this, what's next?
Well, I mean, Google's no stranger to doing this to their properties. They actually just completed doing, you know, Star Wars-izing everything. And I'll tell you why they're doing this today. Today is actually the launch day for Twilight Princess HD, which was a game back in 2006 in the GameCube. And the Wii. Sam, have you had a chance to check out the HD version yet? Are you excited about that?
No, I played both the GameCube and the original Wii versions of Twilight Princess, and I actually was the kind of person who thought I wanted the Wind Waker. I liked the whimsy. I liked the creativity. I liked the attempt to try something new by having a Zelda game go out to sea. And I actually really thought Twilight Princess was a regression. It was, let's do things the way the fanboys and fangirls want, and they're clamoring for something that looks just like Ocarina of Time. So that one never really did it for me. I've also, in terms of Google Maps, I'm more partial to the Dragon Warrior / Dragon Quest styled Google Maps, which were the 8-bitified ones that launched, I want to say, in 2012, where they took all the images and everything, all the trees and mountains and grass and roads were all rendered in this old Dragon Warrior, Dragon Quest 8-bit style, which reminded me of my childhood days of grinding and never beating those dang games. So, you know. That reminds me of like getting lost on my way to, yeah, there it is. Yeah, that's what my old neighborhood looks like.
That is better. That is actually much better.
Well, Sam, thank you once again for joining us. And thank you. I didn't mean to mock you. I love your enthusiasm of VR. And
quit insulting our guests.
And I hope you'll come back.
Well, I mean, I do have this really fascinating place to go for the rest of the day, but I do have to come up for air and food and compassion, and they've yet to really get the friendship simulator going on this yet. But
okay.
Until that day comes, I will happily come on over here. And in the meantime, I will have a lot more about this guy up at Ars Technica this week, as does Kyle Orland, who also was fortunate enough to get one of these bad boys. We actually have a virtual reality deathmatch date coming up in a few minutes once he's put his kids to bed on the East Coast. So I'm going to go get this thing wired up to the computer and start planning to shoot him in the virtual face.
All right, Sam, go kill him. Yeah. No, this just doesn't work. Sorry. Thank you for coming on today.
Right.
We'll
Take
see
care,
you later,
Sam.
All right, TNT's fan of the day is David Grant, who sent us this panoramic image, first panoramic image we've gotten to us, saying dogs napping, flags flapping, and hammock time with Friday TNT. Nice bunker you got there. Check out that bunker.
I think I can see that Google antenna from here.
Or you can feel it.
Yes.
Show us how you watch or listen to TNT. Just record a video, take a picture of yourself or your setup, post it on Instagram, Google+, Twitter, Facebook, Peach, if it still exists, and use the hashtag #HowIWatchTNT, and we are hopefully going to find it. We'll certainly be looking for it. All right, up next, the dangers of binge watching. But first, let's take a minute to thank the sponsor of this episode, PillPack. We've all done the pharmacy dance. It's not nearly as fun as it sounds. There's actually not a whole lot of dancing involved. It's more of a standstill as you stand there still in one place, waiting for the pharmacist to give you the medication you need so you can get back to living life and not standing so still. It's time that you discover PillPack. It's the future of pharmacy, and it's available right now. PillPack delivers your medications and vitamins pre-sorted in these little packets right here. You just pull out the packet. It's got all the information that you need. You just tear it right off, open it up, and you got your pills, your medication, whatever you happen to be taking. Here it is. They use robots to sort and personalize these pill packs separately for every customer. Each packet is dispensed through the pharmacy and then sent out through an image recognition system that they built to ensure the right pill is in the right pack. Their system can detect dispensing accuracy by things like shape, size, color, density of each pill, and catalogs an image of every single packet dispensed. In addition, each packet is checked by a pharmacist for accuracy and interactions prior to shipment, so that human touch is there as well. If you ever have any questions, their pharmacists are available to you 24/7 from the privacy of your own home. No more long lines, no more awkward pharmacy encounters. They proactively contact your doctor to manage your refills for you so you'll never run out. And switching is easy. You can sign up on their secure site, and they'll take care of everything for you. It's compatible with most major insurance plans, including most forms of Medicare Part D. No extra cost beyond your standard copays, and shipping is always free. Been recognized by Time Magazine as a top 25 invention. Jill Duffy actually gave it a great review on PC Magazine, who named PillPack an editor's choice health service. There's also a PillPack medication reminder app for the iPhone and Apple Watch. PillPack has brought the pharmacy into the digital age and into your home. And once you make the switch, you'll wonder how you ever lived without it. So here's what you should do. Visit pillpack.com/twit. You can sign up right now. Their site is awesome. It only takes 5 minutes to sign up. And when you use our link and transfer your prescriptions to PillPack, you'll get a credit for $20 worth of vitamins and OTCs. That's PillPack.com/TWIT. Thank you, PillPack. All right, on the day of the release of the fourth season of House of Cards on Netflix, I leave you with this morsel of truth. Binge watching your favorite shows could leave you empty, depressed, and downright bored when all is said and done. Quartz conducted a study of 406 North American adults from a data collection platform online. 35% admitted to binge watching TV, and by and large, the data revealed, at the very least, a correlation between binge watching, screen time, and mental health status, though they were upfront to that point, and also to point out that it should not be construed, at least at this point, as causation. I don't know. What do you think, Ken? Is House of Cards depressing you when it's done?
I think anytime you finish something that was awesome, you realize it's over, you're going to be depressed. So there's no surprises there.
Yeah.
Yeah, but then you get to be excited again. I'm super excited. And Louie also just got released on Netflix. And I think I took a little informal poll. I think I need to do House of Cards first because that's the one that has the spoilers in it.
Get that out of the way. Mm-hmm. And then you'll come down, you'll get all depressed. And then you'll go, wait a minute, I've got Louie. That's tomorrow night.
Mm-hmm.
And then you'll watch all of Louie episodes tomorrow night. And then what are you going to do the next night, Megan?
I know. I agree. Like, I will say that I do feel sad when a show is done. And then you'll never get that feeling of never seeing it again. But when you get older, my young friends, then you can watch things over again and you've kind of forgotten. Yes,
yeah.
Exactly. I've, done that with The Wire, The Sopranos. Like, it's amazing. Just give it a decade. You've forgotten it all. And
I thought you were going to say, when you get older, you won't have any time to watch TV, which is kind of where I'm at right now. So I guess I don't understand this, at least not in my current life, but I'm sure I'll get back there someday.
Well, the binge watching is so new. It's so funny because my whole family is watching ER, starting from the beginning. We just started. And
you've got a lot of episodes ahead of you if you're starting
ER right now. But ER started in 1994. And I realized a lot of those episodes, those first episodes, I never watched because it wasn't like you could just let's just binge watch it.
No, it was on and then it was gone.
Yeah.
Maybe you'd occasionally catch it on a rerun, but that was it.
Back in my day.
I had this habit of we've got a TV and a computer set up in the kitchen. So I was basically watching 1 to 2 episodes of NCIS from the beginning every night when I did the dishes.
And now you're done?
And yeah, I'm all caught up.
Okay.
So that's a year of my life I'll never get.
I'm trying to figure out if dishwashing viewing is a compliment or not.
I bet there are a lot of people washing their dishes right now.
You're not saying
to
the show, I'm going to give you all of my attention. I'm going to sit on the couch and watch you. You're like, I'm going to do this other thing. I might look up every once in a while, but whatever.
Anyone who's washing dishes while they're listening or watching now, that's fine.
Yeah, it's totally cool.
Fit it in
we'll take it any way we can get it, to be honest.
There you go.
Well, Ken,
NCIS, the white noise of television.
Yeah. Exactly, yes. Ken, thank you so much for coming on. Ken Denmead, your Geek Dad. What is there anything else that you need to tell us?
Well, I will actually put out the call and make the announcement a week from Monday. So that'll be Pi Day, March 14th. Geek Dad and Geek Mom are actually coming together sort of as a giant mecha robot. We're sort of re-merging together into one giant website of geeky parenting. We're going to relaunch the website. They'll be living together in one site now. And we're refreshing all the look and feel of everything. So hopefully people will come and be excited and see that the whole family has kind of come back together to reinvigorate ourselves and just keep writing about all the geeky stuff that we love as parents and, TV, movies, games, everything.
I'm wondering what the united URL will be. Will it be Geek Parents?
You will still be able to get to us at geekdad.com and geekmom.com. There'll be sort of a combo experience. You can find, just a Geek Mom experience, things like that. But we're going to share the house again.
That's good. I'm glad. I was worried for a while.
Yeah, I was too. Yeah. It was getting a little awkward. I'm so happy to hear this.
Yes. Well, thank you so much for coming on. Hopefully we'll talk to you again soon.
It was great to be here again. Yeah. To see you guys.
Thank you, Ken. Best of luck. All right. And on Monday, we are inviting someone very awesome to the show. That would be Liberty Madison. She's coming back. It'll be great to have Liberty back. TNT's records live every Monday through Friday at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern, 12 a.m. UTC at twit.tv/live. You can always take part in the show by emailing us at tnt@twit.tv or leave us a short voicemail. That is 260-TNT-SHOW. And you can find us on Twitter. We are at TechNewsTodayTV.
And if you happen to get us through iTunes, leave a review. Give us some stars. We leave a review, and that's how other people can find us.
Yeah.
You can subscribe to our show at twit.tv/TNT. You can subscribe with whatever podcast catcher on whatever platform and whatever version of the show you want. That's all there to choose from. And if you want to tweet at me, I am at Megan Maroney.
And I am at Jason Howell. Thanks to our technical director, Kara Cole, and all the folks who help us produce this show every single day. And thanks to you for talking tech with us today. We will see you on Monday. Bye, everyone.